start. Father, we thank you again for another good day. It is a good day, Lord. We thank you for all your blessings to us today. Thank you, Lord, for the breath of life. Lord, thank you that we could get up out of bed today. Thank you, Lord, that we were able to be here this morning. Lord, thank you that the weather was such that we could come today. And Lord, we pray again that you would bless our few minutes together. Lord, really, our time on Sunday morning is really quite brief, considered the general scope of things. So, Lord, I pray you'll help us this morning to learn something, we pray, that might help us in our everyday life. Again, we're so grateful for, Lord, the blessings of this past week. And, Lord, we do thank you, Lord, for watching over us this week, for keeping us safe, protecting us. Lord, we pray for those who are, Lord, in a bad way, I guess how I say it. Lord, I think of that Mr. Zare, Lord, that we have prayed for, had the lung transplant, and now some serious complications. They're not even sure he'll make it, but we pray for him. And Father, for others who are not doing well, Lord, I see so many prayer requests. People ask for prayer for their mother, for their brother, for their sister, for their dad, for their family, for themselves, Lord. And we lift people up to you through the throne of grace today. I'm sure that, Lord, I'm sure that everybody in this room probably would have something they'd like to pray about. And so, Lord, we thank you today that you're a prayer-hearing God and that, Lord, you delight in answering our prayers. And, Lord, we pray that you'll give us the faith to believe that you will answer our prayers. Lord, you said if we had the faith to believe, even as a grain of a mustard seed, Lord, we could have mountain-moving faith. Father, again, we pray you bless the Sunday school hour. Open your word to us. Give us clearness of thought. We pray. Bless in these few moments in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right, very good. Well, anybody have a question today? Ryan. Ryan and then Sarah. Ryan.
I'm pretty sure I understand that Judas went to hell, but there's a part in there where it says he repented, and I know he didn't repent to God. He repented to the people he sold Jesus to and gave back the money. Am I correct in thinking that it wasn't a full repentance to God, but just he just felt sorry for getting caught pretty much?
Yes, you are. It's like, use this because we've mentioned this several times about the word repent. The word repent means to change your mind, which would lead to a change of action. In Judas's case, he did repent. He said, I betrayed innocent blood, which led to a change of action. He threw the money back at them. He gave the money back. Now, did he repent to God? No. You know, the question of what happened to Judas, there are people, I'm probably not one of them, but there are people who believe that Judas Iscariot will be resurrected. The Antichrist will be a resurrected Judas Iscariot because the Bible says that he went to his own place. This is what the Bible says about Judas. He's called the son of perdition. And then when he died, he went to his own place, whatever that may mean. People then surmise that he may be the Antichrist resurrected. I'm not one of them, but there are people who do believe that. So anyway, repent means to change your mind, and I guess he repented to the fact that he had betrayed. He said this, I betrayed innocent blood. Why did Judas do what he did? Well, to begin with, he was a devil from the beginning. The Bible makes that clear. Judas was never saved. Had a devil from the beginning, but then at the Lord's table, says that Judas entered, the devil entered into Judas, and he went out. Jesus said, what thou doest, do quickly. What is amazing to me is when Peter said to John, ask Jesus who it is he's talking about. When Jesus said, one of you at this table shall betray me. And Peter asked John, well, ask him who it is. And Jesus said, it is he that dippeth his hand with me, to whom I give the sop or morsel of bread. And he handed it to Judas. Yet the disciples did not recognize Because they thought that when Judas left, he went out to do something about Passover. And did Judas repent toward God? No. No, he didn't do that, but he repented of what he had done. Said he was sorry, but... I believe, and who knows the mind of a person who, but I believe he was so overcome by guilt that he could not live with that. Sarah.
Monday night, we were talking at the homeschool moms meeting about generational sins. And I know there's scripture that talks about generational sins, but they got talking about how the sins that we've committed before our kids. So I think of like Doug and I in our situation, they were saying like Marissa's going to pay for that. And I didn't really have an answer, but like I don't think that's right. If we're saved and our sins are forgiven, then why would my kids have to pay for that?
Right. Which is a good question. There are verses in the Bible that, and I cannot recall any offhand, that sins of the father will be visited on the children. Now, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, and I could be, but I believe that those would be basically Old Testament verses. Not that we're opposed to the Old Testament anyway, but, you know, the Old Testament law was basically this, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's what the Old Testament law was. And it is apparent, like with David, when you read in Kings, you read that, like Solomon, the Bible says that Solomon's heart was turned away from God in his old age. And it's amazing about Solomon, how God loves Solomon, and the Bible says, for the Lord loves Solomon, and how that Solomon's wives turned his heart away from God. And he built temples, and he built altars for all these false gods. And it was either Gad or Nathan came to Solomon and said that, he said, because of what you've done, you know, the kingdom will be taken. But, and it happened with Rehoboam, his son, Jeroboam, of course, there was that great division of Israel and Judah because of sins. Now, the question is, does God visit the sins of the parents upon the children today? And my answer to that would be, I'll play politician on this one, yes and no. I would say to lost people, people who are not saved, and they, I'm not saying because your father was a drunk that you'll turn out that way, but there's a good chance. Now, I know that there are people who don't. I know my friend John, who passed away, his father, who, I like to say it this way, his father was quite thirsty, and he loved to drink. And because of that, John and Tom both would never drink. They would never do that. But to say that, okay, because, you know, that's like saying, if you stop and think about this, that's like saying that every sin I've ever committed, well, if that were true, then it's going to fall upon my kids. I look at that, Sarah, as basically an Old Testament kind of thing. I simply don't find that in the New Testament. Really, our sins are forgiven. The slate's been wiped clean. And I just simply do not see that as my sins. Now, maybe if I was lost, or maybe if I, was a dope fiend or something like that, and my kids, I look at my dad, dad smoked, and he smoked a lot, and when we were kids, back, you know, in the late 50s, early 60s, before they came out with the Surgeon General warnings, I can remember walking in, I couldn't have been more than I could have been more than 10 or 11 years old. And I remember walking into the store where we lived, Armistead Gardens, up around the corner from us at the drugstore. I walk up to the counter, and the lady looks at me and said, "You want a pack of Pall Malls?" I mean, I'm only like 10 years old. And in that sense, well, my parents smoked, my dad smoked, and that's what everybody did. And so in that sense, I could see that that would be so. But we who are saved and our sins are forgiven and the slate's been wiped clean, I would say that thing about the sins being passed upon, generational sins, let me look at that, but I just don't see that. I really don't see that. We live in the age of grace, and I'm thankful for that. We are not under the Old Testament law, and so that would, you know, I think that would negate that, really.
Yeah, I feel like it contradicted everything. You know, if our slate is wiped clean and God has forgiven all our sins, it's kind of like he's going back on that. So I was struggling with that whole conversation, but I've heard that those verses. I just couldn't.
Right. I would say, as I'm thinking of the New Testament, and of course you can't think of everything, but as I'm thinking about it, I just don't recall any verses in the New Testament that would really apply to that. Anybody think? Ken does. Ken?
The Bible says, raise a child up, and he will not turn from it. If you listen to the radio during the week, you know, on the Moose, they'll give their arrest report, and it's usually it's a generational thing, and they're, you know, I don't know personally, but they seem like lost people.
Right.
And
now that you bring it up, let me find that verse. Pretty sure I know where that is. You're right. You did chop that up pretty good. Bible says, train up a child the way that he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart. What Ken said is true. I know somebody, I do know this person, and I've talked with this person the other day, and this person, I've known them for a long time, and this person is really a good guy. He really is. But he got arrested several times for DWI. One time he went to jail for a while in another state because of it. And he told me the other day, he just said to me, man, he said, I am still struggling with that. He said, I'm trying to get by that. He said, I'm trying AA. He said, I'm trying anything. But I heard on, you know, the Moose, I heard his son was arrested the other day for the same thing. And so, you know, it's that kind of thing with lost people. And we're not trying to, you know, make lost people feel bad, but, you know, lost people do those kind of things. And kids aren't stupid. I mean, they watch what their parents do. They're going to probably do the same thing. It's like I said, dad smoked, and I'm not proud of the things I've done, but I must have been 6, 7 years old when I tried my first cigarette, because, hey, that's what dad did. That's what my friend's parents did. That's what everybody did. That's what they did. They smoked, and of course, we didn't know all the bad things about it now, but, you know, and so, you know, I know I'm hitting that, but it's just one thing. But, you know, if people drink, you know, if dad drinks, then chances are the kids probably will. That's why it's important, as Ken brought out, that if you train up a child in the way that he should go, while he is going, he'll not depart from it. Now, I know, and I understand this fully. Let me just say this real, and this will not be quick. Here's the thing about, Dave, I thought you were going to clean this place out up here.
You told me once never to do it.
I know it, but about Let me say this. You probably are not going to agree with this, but I'm going to say it anyway. All right, okay, I know you will. You have got to let your kids go. Look, we live in a very wicked, ungodly, and like I said, an unsafe world. And I realize that the day in which we live is not the same as it was when I was a kid or when some of you were kids. When I was a kid, when some of you who are older were kids, you would go off all day. And it was time to come home when it was dark and your mother was yelling for you to get in the house. We would go off all day, we would play. I said this, that when by the time I was 10, I was riding the Baltimore City buses by myself. I would not let a 10-year-old kid on a Baltimore City bus by themselves today. I realize, I understand that times have changed. I know that. But you have got to begin to let your kids go from the day that they're born, because one day they're going to be gone. And if you shield your kids, if you try, you can't shield your kids from all the evil that's in the world. You may try, but you can't do that. And when one day when they get out, they'll go crazy. So what do you mean, preacher? I cannot tell you. Because I cannot tell you how many people that I know who raised their kids in such a strict upbringing that they never saw the bad in the world. And when they got out and got a taste of it, they don't even go to church anymore. In many cases, they've turned their back on the church. And they've gotten out of the church. Now, I'm not saying, okay, let your kids go out and try dope, drink, and all that stuff. But they need to be aware that this is an ungodly, wicked world. And they need to see some of that stuff, because when they get out, that's what I think, when the Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go. Well, should you let the kids go down to the bar? Well, no, of course not. But they need to know that there are wicked places like that. They need to know that there are wicked people like that. I mean, we live just in an ungodly kind of world, and that's why we need to train our children so that when they grow up, they'll not depart. Now, I know that some people get away from God. I know that. I'm well aware of that. My old teacher, Dr. Ken Chapman, I've said this several times, that he had known many people in his life who he believed to be saved and trusted had been saved. And when they got older, kind of got away from God. But he said this, and I don't guess I've ever known this personally in my own life, but he said this. He said, I've never known a person who was, can we use the word genuine? I hate that word, genuinely saved, because if you're saved, you're genuinely saved or truly saved. But he said, I've never known a person who was truly saved, if they got away from God, that some point in their life, they eventually returned to God. Now, I know that there are always, always exceptions to just about every rule you can come up with, except maybe in math. But you know, there are exceptions to the rules, and you know, it may be true. Some people never come back to God that are saved and eventually die, still go to heaven. But, you know, we need to not necessarily, you know, throw our kids out, throw them to the wolves and say, here, go out and see what the world's like. But our kids need to be aware of what's going on and to try to shelter them until they're 21, and then they open the door and say, whoa. You know, we need to let our kids go. As hard as it is, letting my kids go and letting my boys go, that was a hard thing. I didn't want to let them go. I wanted them to stay and torment me the rest of their life. But I have found this out, that, you know, you got to let them go. They've got to experience things in their life. Sometimes it's not good. I've said this about Tim. I honestly thought when Tim left, he'd never come home again. I really thought that about Tim. When he left for Alaska, I never really thought Tim would ever come back home again. But, you know, kids grow up, they mature. They figure some things out, and, you know, it's we just have to do that. But anyway, I don't know how that got to Sarah's question, but anyway, so anybody else got a question today about anything? If you do, we'll try and answer it. Go home once. Oh, yeah. I'm not going down that road today. Okay, all you teachers, you can beat John up today for that one, okay? I believe Dave raised his hand. Go.
So the Old Testament.
Yes, sir.
Our sins will be carried over to the third, fourth generation.
Yes, sir.
Jesus breaks that.
Okay.
So if you're not under Jesus, is that promise or... Because in working with kids and people over the years, I watch.
Right.
Alcohol, abuse. Right. All this stuff, and the chains just continue,
right.
Generation after generation after generation, but I see breaks in. Sometimes they just do it. Most of the time it's Jesus makes a difference in the
absolutely.
Life. Absolutely. And then the chain is broken. It's still a struggle for them.
Absolutely. It's like alcohol. We'll just say that, okay? Because alcohol's particularly... I know that we have a drug problem in this county. Well, let's face it, there's a drug problem all over America. And you know, and I'll just say this, the legalizing of marijuana, that doesn't help stuff. That doesn't help. Ben lives in Colorado and you know it's legal in Colorado, and he said the real problem they have there is all these dope addicts come out there because you can get it and smoke it, and now you got all these people living on the street. But anyway, let's say alcohol. I know a guy, he's in heaven now. I have no... Oakley O'Brien. He and my dad went business together. He was O, my dad was J. They called it OJ. What a name. OJ contractor, but anyway. So Oak was the biggest drunk in the town of Bel Air. I mean, he was the biggest drunk. His wife was saved. She played the organ in the church where we were saved. But Oak was the biggest drunk. He beat his wife. He'd lock her outside. He'd lock her out in the pouring rain. She'd beating on the door, begging to let him in, let her in, let her in. I mean, he just, biggest drunk. I remember the night he got saved. I remember that night. And what Dave said is so true. That the night that Oakley got saved, I know how he did it. It's the power of God. That's how. He never took another drink again as long as he lived. He was a changed man, became a deacon in the church. He was a changed man. What made the difference? Christ made the difference. There was a study done, and I can't tell you their names. I just remember reading it once, and I remember hearing a preacher use it once. There were two guys, they traced their children. One guy, they were both from colonial era, founding of the country era. One was a saved guy. One was a moral upstanding guy. The other guy was a drunk. That's what he was. Then they traced the drunk's descendants down, and that's pretty much what they were. And I'm not being unkind, but they were a real blight, a real hindrance to society. That's what they were. The other guy, a moral guy, a saved guy, there were several senators, there were a couple presidents, there were governors, and the descendants of that guy, that righteous moral guy, they were a blessing to society. And so Dave's point, which is really good, and I believe that is valid. What makes the difference? What changes things? Well, the answer to that can be, I know that people go to AA, I was going to say AAA. They probably go to that too. And they go to Alcoholics Anonymous. They go to Gamblers Anonymous. They go to Drug Anonymous. They go to Shopping Anonymous. You know, there are people that are addicted to the shopping channel. But, you know, it's like all these things. Can those kind of things, well, yeah, they can help sometimes. I'm sure that there are people who have been helped by Alcoholics Anonymous. I'm sure that's true. But the person who can make the real change, the real difference in anybody's life is Christ. And if there is anything that breaks that chain, would be Christ. He makes the difference. That's why, what is it, 2 Corinthians 5:17? Therefore, if any man be in who? Christ. He is a new creature. Old things will pass away. The old things that were once in our life. Now, again, you know, sometimes some of you have been saved for a long time. Great. Some of you have not been saved as long as others. Okay, that's still good. Some have not been saved as long as others. That's okay. That's all right. Too often, we who have been saved a long time want you who have been saved a short time to be just like me. Well, you say, well, thank God I'm not like you, preacher. Amen. I'm glad you're not like me too. Amen. But amen. That's right. And so it's like, we want to grow in grace. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to move. We're leaning slightly forward in our walk with Christ. So that Paul said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the calling of God, high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's what we're doing. We're pressing on the upward way, new heights we're gaining every day. Do we falter? Absolutely. And when young Christians fail, we're too quick to point a finger and say, ah, that guy must not be saved. However, and we're too quick to do that. But we who are saved, we have been saved a long time, short time, little time. Man, we're growing in grace. And we're trying. Old things will pass away. I do not do now what I did when I was first saved. I don't do that anymore. What I did when I was first saved, I don't do that anymore. Do I still do things? Well, absolutely. Sure I do. 1 John 1:9 says this. 1 John 1:9, talking to believers. But if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's the account of Jesus washing the disciples' feet, John 13. While it may be a good story in it, and you know, I know churches where they wash feet. They have a foot washing service every time they have the Lord's table. They have a foot washing service. Again, if that's what they believe, God bless them. I was never led that way. I'm not sure that's what that account is teaching us. But it does teach us this, that when we walk through this world, our feet get dirty and they need to be washed. Now, are we already washed? Yeah, washed from our sins in his own blood. But here's my point. I'm trying to get back to 2 Corinthians 5:17. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. We are new. Old things will pass away. Now, they may not pass away. With Oak, he quit drinking the night he got saved. The night he got saved, he never drank again. Now, Dad, and I know Oakley too, because he and Dad went to business together, and I believe Oak smoked till the day he died. I believe he did. Dad got saved when he was like 39 years old, which in and of itself was a miracle. 39 years old. He never kicked the habit until he was 52. Sometimes it's just hard to break old habits. I know. Listen to me. I know people have a problem with language. I know that. Man, that language thing gets ingrained in you, and you... And when you're around lost people talk like that, and you know, old things pass away. Is it hard to break that habit? Yeah. When I see a brother in Christ or a sister in Christ, and they have a problem with that, you know, I just, God bless you. I'll sure pray for you. But what makes the difference? Well, Christ makes the difference. And it is, again, as Dave pointed out, it is a generational thing. That generational thing can only be broken, really, in my opinion, by the Lord Jesus Christ. He sets us free, and he breaks the chains of sin, and we are bound by that, and he redeems us from the sin market. I have a song I love to sing since I have been redeemed. All right, anybody else got a comment, or you want to say something, or you got a question?
One more,
and then Pete. Go ahead.
I work with people, friends and family, of an addiction group.
and these have family members that were addicts that have gotten saved, broke that chain, started going to church. And then these people come to this group for support. And I ask them, you know, why are you coming? I watched my son, daughter, husband, wife. They got saved. They broke that chain of addiction. I had to have that in my life.
Amen.
So the chains get broken and it goes uphill.
Amen.
All over because of that testimony, that witness.
Amen.
That that saved family member has.
That, and that's important. I may have told you this. The night I got saved.
On March 16th on a Sunday night. Like most teenagers, my dad and I had our fair share of go-arounds. And he said to me that night after church, he said, son, would you go in and talk to the preacher about being saved? This is what I said to him. I said, Dad, now let me back up and say this. Was I under conviction? Absolutely. Did I really believe that I need to be saved? Absolutely, I did. But I said, Dad, do you want me to get saved? And he looked at me and said, absolutely, I do. And see, that's where the testimony, whether you like it or not, people are watching you. They are watching you. And anyway, Pete, you wanted to say something, brother?
Yeah, in our prayer request, one of the first ones about the drug problems in Lewis County. And I've been praying about that, and a lot of people have been caught since then. But I heard on the radio the other day, two more people got caught, and their last name was Fitzgeralds. I just want you to know, I don't know them people. But I'm glad they got caught. God answers prayer.
Okay, Pete. There are a lot of Fitzgeralds. And Ryan is going to tell us something.
I was just thinking, just where sin is generational, the opposite is true, too. Because had Grandpa never gotten saved, I don't think Dad would have been in the youth group he was in to meet Mom. And had Mom never gotten saved, she would have went down the same path as the rest of her family. And then us three children wouldn't be here, and all of us are saved and in church. And Danielle and Royce have their children in church. And so does that mean they're going to follow the path? Not necessarily, but they have a much bigger chance.
Absolutely.
All because his wife got saved. I mean, that just, when you think about that, that is absolutely amazing. How one person can so influence the coming generations. You think about Abel. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, Abel being dead yet speaketh. Being dead yet speaketh. And so that's true of us. What an inheritance, really, when you think about it. To have godly grandparents, godly parents. And as Ryan said, does that mean that we will definitely follow their steps? No. But it sure is a help when they're that way. When Grandpa goes to church, I think Pete's testimony is he got saved in 1969. That, and as far as I know about Pete, and I've known Pete since 1976, I don't think I've ever known Pete to really be out of church. And so what a testimony that is. Anybody else, they got something they want to say, they got a comment, or if you have another question, we'll try and answer it. Anybody else got a question? All right. Okay. Anybody else does? All right. Then we are in Revelation chapter 11 today. Thank you for those comments. Revelation chapter 11. Excuse me. Revelation chapter 11. We, up to this point, up to this point, beginning in chapter 4, up to this point, we have seen a judgment poured out upon the world, the governments of the world, and the people of the world. And the book of Revelation now begins to shift a little bit, because we're going to now begin to see God's judgments poured out on the ecclesiastical world. We live in a time today. We live in a time today. I know we hear about a one world government, the new world order, all those kind of things where, you know, people are looking to try to get the governments and we kind of hit maybe a slowdown with that. I know that President Trump is, you know, America first. He is for America first. I'm for America first. He's for breaking, you know, the NAFTA treaty, and he's not for the Trans-Pacific Partnership treaty. He's not for that. England got out of the common market, out of the European Union, and we've kind of, you know, maybe hit a little detour on that thing right now. But the goal, the one world government, their goal, their idea is that countries without borders. The United States of America, we need to have borders. You're not a country, as President Trump has said. If you don't have borders, you're not really a country. And so, you know, we're seeing that fight right now, how three judges overrode the will of the people. And really, if you read the law, President Trump has every right, according to the law, to put a temporary ban. President Obama, the icon, the idol of the left, did the same thing for 6 months, and you never heard a peep out of the left over that. But President Trump does it. Well, I don't want to get down that road. But anyway, so we've got the New World Order where we are, and there is going to be, mark it down, there is going to be a New World Order. There is going to be a one world government. That is going to happen. Now, it may not happen as quickly as we think, or something may happen tomorrow that may absolutely usher it in. You know, nobody knows that. We can look at the general course of things and say, well, we're headed in that way. I've often thought this, that it doesn't matter who is in power, whether it's the Democrats or the Republicans, America is still going in the same direction. Now, with the Republicans, we may go a little slower than what the Democrats do, but we're still going in the same direction. Now, we're looking at that. Whether we see it in our lifetime or not, I do not know. But not only are we looking at that one world government, but we're looking at a one world kind of religion. And we're going to see that when we get to a little bit farther in Revelation. But now the judgments that have been poured out, the seven seals and the seven trumpets have been poured out upon the governments of the world. We're now going to begin to see these judgments poured out upon the ecclesiastical or the religious powers in the world. We're going to see that begin to happen. We're living in a time, again, where the religions are trying to get together. I'm constantly invited to get together with all the other churches in the county. You know, why don't you come down? We're going to have this meeting. I'm sure he's a nice guy. I mean this. I'm sure he is. I'm not even going to tell you who it was. But I met a preacher at a funeral one day, not too long ago, and he said, hey, would you like to get involved with all the other churches in the county doing something? I was gracious. And, you know, all I said to him was, well, send me the information. We got invited to sing with the American Baptist Church in Boonville. We got invited to sing with the United Methodist Church in Boonville. We got invited to sing with the Catholic Church in Boonville. And if there's any other church in Boonville, we got invited to sing there one year for a Christmas kind of thing. You know, let's get all the churches together. and do that. Let's have a spirit of unity. I called one of them. I did. And I tried to be gracious. I'm serious. I really tried to be gracious, but I just asked the guy. I said, look, they don't even believe the Bible, so how can we get along? The guy really got pretty mad, and I actually hung up on me. I just, you know, okay, fine. I've been hung up on before. I'm a big boy. That doesn't bother me. That does not bother me too much. But we are living in a time. I got a letter the other day. I don't even remember who it was from, but they were having a big kind of ecumenical meeting up in Beaver Falls. Beaver River's a school, Beaver Falls. And they were having a big ecumenical meeting up there, and they wanted me to come up. And then I filed that in a circular file. But we're seeing where I think the Pope said all Christians ought to learn to get along with Muslims. Now, he didn't say that to the Muslims to get along with Christians, but he said that the Christians ought to get along with Muslims. Well, you know, that ain't going to work. There are churches that believe that Baptists are merely, I'm sorry, not Baptists, believe that Protestants are merely brethren who have erred from the faith and that we need to bring them back. And I'll give you an example. You know, I talk about my brothers often, and I'll tell you, God sure gave me a boatload of illustrations when he gave me my seven brothers. My one brother, I believe that my brother is saved. I believe that he is saved. I can't help believe otherwise. I'll ask you this question. I'll ask this question. Can a person who is saved get into error? Yes or no? Can they? Yes, they can. They sure can. There have been many, many people who I believe were saved who got off into error. And I mean serious error. And they got off into it. I believe that my brother is saved. I believe that he is. I cannot help but believe otherwise. But he is and I'm not even sure what you call him. I think, and Dave may know this more so than I, what are they called, preachers in the Episcopal Church?
Father.
All right. In the Episcopal Church. I don't know if you know anything about the Anglican Church. The Anglican Church was started by Henry VIII, who, because the Pope would not give him a divorce, said, well, if you're going to be that way about it, we're out of here. And he started the Anglican Church, which is nothing more than the Catholic branch of the Roman Catholic Church. And my brother is a Reformed Episcopalian Anglican, whatever that may be. And he wears the robes and, you know, he puts on the backward collar and every once in a while the Catholic priest will come into his church and he'll go over to the Catholic church and, you know, they're buddy-buddy and everything is, you know, hey, we're, you know, all the same faith. I can't help but believe that my brother is saved, but is he in error? Well, I certainly believe that he is. And it's like my other brother. My other brother went from being a Methodist to being somewhat Baptistic to being a Presbyterian to now he's in the Russian Orthodox Church. And I'm serious when I say this. I mean, to join the Russian Orthodox Church, you have to renounce everything you used to believe. My brother believes that we are heretics. You have to be rebaptized in a number 2 wash tub in your underwear. and they pour water over you and rebaptize you. And you have to renounce all everything you ever believed. Do I believe that my brother, was he saved? Well, if he was saved, he still is saved. But is he in error? Well, I think so. A person who is saved can get it off into error. Are they still saved? Well, if we understand the Bible correctly, they are. And so, let me say this. Do I think I'm right about everything? Well, I was right about the Patriots, but anyway, you know, am I right about everything? I would not be so foolish to think that I'm right about everything. However, oh, here we go with the but, however, I honestly believe this, that if you'll put every book you have away and pick your Bible up and read the Bible. Now, we may not agree on every crossing of the T and every dotting of the I, but I believe that if you'll just pick your Bible up and read it, that you will probably, I think that you will basically come to the same conclusions that I have come to by simply reading the Bible. Do I read other books? Absolutely, I do. Do I read other commentaries? Sure, I do. But foremost, I read the Bible. But we are now coming to a place, and I tell you this about my one dear brother. He got into trouble when he started reading all these other books. And he started reading what these other guys said instead of what God said. Because I have heard him say this. A, number one, he believes the Bible is an allegory. He does not believe that it means what it says. We try to interpret the Bible literally on a literal sense. We do not try to spiritualize. Are there spiritual things? Sure there are. Are there allegories in here? Of course there are. But when the Bible talks about a man named David, I believe there was a man named David who became king over Israel. I don't think my brother really believes that. I don't think he does anymore. Was there a giant named Goliath that had five brothers? Well, absolutely. I just read the Bible and believe it's true. The problem that people have is when they get off and they begin to read books by other people who may contain some error and they do not discern the error, and then they begin to follow the error. If you ever read The Trail of Blood, if you don't have a copy of it, I'll get you a copy of it. I believe it was written by a man named B.H. Carroll. Trail of Blood basically traces religions back to the time of the apostles. Of course, many of them did not start. Hey, look, the Methodist. They didn't come about until the 1700s. John Wesley, I believe Wesley was a godly man. I believe Charles Wesley, his brother, wrote a lot of songs that we sing. I believe they were godly men, but I believe they got and went down some wrong roads. It's like my brother. Look, I believe that Jesus, I believe that Christ was immersed. I believe that John the Baptist, John the Baptizer, I believe he immersed people. I believe the Ethiopian was immersed. My brother Keith, God bless him, I love him. You know, he said to me one day, you remember in Acts chapter 2 when I think on the day of Pentecost, I think there were like 3,000 or 5,000, one of the two. I think it were 3,000 people got saved on the day of Pentecost. The Bible says, and they that gladly received his word were baptized. My brother, in all honesty, looked at me and said, where'd they get all that water to baptize people if they didn't sprinkle them? Well, man, if God can save them, surely he can provide enough water to baptize them. Amen? Amen. And it's like, Dave made a comment, and he made this comment about the law was until Jesus. Here's what I think happened. The Bible says this, that the law and the prophets were until John. My brother said John was an Old Testament priest. Oh, there was no Old Testament priest like John. The law and the prophets were until John. He was in the wilderness baptizing. And my brother just simply says, well, he dipped the reed in the water and sprinkled people with it. No, the law and the prophets were until John. Something happened with John. And things began, there was a difference. He was the forerunner of Christ. And that brought about the change as we see it. But now we're seeing this gradual movement back. I know that people think that we're nuts. We are, but anyway. Yeah, I know it. I am. Was that old saying? Well, you know, somebody told me in here, I was a real nut job or fruitcake or something, and I readily admit that. What's that old saying? Everybody in the world's crazy but me and you, and I have my doubts about you. But, you know, so it's like we're seeing this gradual, well, let's just love everybody and let's everybody, let's get a common Bible. You know, I know that people say, well, man, you guys make a big thing about the King James Bible. Absolutely I do. Sure I do. Because I see this gradual, let's try to find a common denominator Bible that everybody can agree with. And again, we're looking, we're going down. And so in Revelation chapter 11, which we did not get to today, but in Revelation chapter 11, we're going to begin to see the judgment of the religions of the world. And Lord willing, next time we'll try to take a look at that and see that. But so we're out of time. It's 25 after again. Thank you very much for being here. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for another day. And thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. Lord, we would not probably be so bold and brash to say we're right about everything. Lord, I'm sure there are probably some things that we probably could stand some correcting on. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, open your word to us that we might rightly divide it. And Lord, that we might, Lord, see the truth. Father, I pray that you'll help us. Lord, I pray that we might just read the Bible. Lord, I think if we just read the Bible, we'd all basically, I know not in everything, but we basically come to the same conclusions about what we believe. Father, we thank you for that. Lord, I pray again now that you'll bless our time. Lord, help us as grandparents and as parents to love our kids, pray for our kids. Lord, pray for our grandchildren. Lord, pray for them. It is obvious that we live in a world that has forsaken God. I believe that we live in a country that, Lord, you've let us go. Lord, I believe that you've let us go. We're like that ship in Acts 27 where they cut the rudder bands and they just let her drive. We are being driven by the winds of humanism. We are being driven by the winds of secularism. We are being driven by the winds of atheism, agnosticism, and Lord, we're headed for the rocks. God, I pray that you'll help us to rightly divide the word of truth and, Lord, to love our children. To love our children. Lord, to keep them, to train them in a way that they should go so that when they are old, they will not depart. Father, bless the next hour, we pray. Thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen.